We're in the book of Acts, chapter 9, as we continue to journey through the New Testament church. The title of the message, Close Encounters of the Third Kind. Yeah. So I need to ask you guys for a little indulgence. Please indulge your pastor for a little while as we kind of open up the sermon this morning with a little how many sci-fi fans in here? Okay, so we're going to kind of tippy-toe through that. But if you guys will allow for me to do that, I promise you that I'll tie it all in. I won't get too crazy with you guys, all right? But what I want to do this morning is to take the life of Saul, who had an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ, and kind of take some truths from his encounter that kind of point to us that when we have a real encounter with Jesus, that you don't walk away from that encounter the same. Anybody agree with that? And again, the Lord doesn't come into our lives just to kind of, you know, make nice, you know, I know your life's a mess now, okay, you're going to heaven, you come to church on Sunday, raise your hand, praise me, and then going about your business. God comes into our lives to do something radical. I know he's done that in my life. And for anyone who has that encounter, that real encounter with him, I believe he wants to do that in all of our lives. So, how many are sci-fi fans? We got that. Ever heard of the phrase close encounters? Anybody ever heard of that? Yeah, some of us have. That phrase, that terminology, was actually coined by an astronomer by the name of J. Allen Hynek. And he started that terminology and also the system of classification, that system being close encounters. There's close encounter of the first kind. That's when a person visually sees a quote-unquote UFO. Then there's a close encounter of the second kind, where an individual notices that there is some kind of effect from a UFO that has to do with, say, like an automobile malfunctioning or something going wrong with an electronic device, like in Poltergeist with the TV and all that. Then there is close encounter of the third kind. And that's where an individual actually sees an animate being, in other words, an alien or something otherworldly. And the reason why I'm using this terminology and pointing to that is I submit to you this morning that Saul had an encounter with an otherworldly being. Would anybody in here agree with that? Yeah. Yeah, he had a close encounter of the third kind where he literally face-to-face met Jesus. And again, the purpose was to turn Paul's life upside down. And because of that encounter with Paul on the road to Damascus, the whole world at that time was impacted, but the world is still being impacted by that encounter, right? Writer of 75% of the New Testament, a life that was sold out for Jesus, but sold out for Jesus in the wrong way, meeting Jesus on the road to Damascus, being corrected in his theology, if you will, and then living his life, the rest of his life, for the glory of God. And so with that in mind, a real encounter with Jesus reveals certain truths. Hopefully we'll be able to see those this morning. So let's take a look at Acts chapter 9, verse 1. Now Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked for letters from him to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, that's Christians, both men and women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. As he was traveling, it happened that he was approaching Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. And he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, Who are you, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. Get up and enter the city, and it will be told you what you must do. Verse 7, the men who traveled with him stood speechless, hearing the voice, but seeing no one. Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could not see nothing. And leading him by the hand, they brought him into Damascus, in verse 9, and he was there 3 days without sight and neither ate nor drink. So Saul is on the road to Damascus. He's received authority from the high priest to go to a foreign city, breathing threats and murder, the Bible says, to bring those of the way, Christians bound, back to Jerusalem. And he has this encounter with the Lord, and it changes his life. Now, there are two other places in the Acts where Paul recounts those and that encounter. And I just want to briefly look over them, if you will. Turn to Acts 22. Because what I want to submit to us this morning, what I want to show you guys is Paul was zealous for God. And we'll see that in the scriptures. But he was zealous in the wrong way. Because his theology, again, was not right. It was false. And I asked this question in morning service, in early service. How many of us know that we can be absolutely zealous for the wrong thing? And so it doesn't matter how zealous I am. That doesn't mean that what I'm doing is right. It has to line up with the truth of God's word. And so Paul was zealous. He thought he was doing the right thing. In the book of Acts, chapter 22, look at verse 3 and 4. I am a Jew born in Tarsus, Cilicia. But brought up in this city, educated under Gamaliel. Gamaliel was one of the leading rabbis at that time. Strictly according to the law of our fathers, being zealous for God. There it is, zealous for God, as you all are today. I persecuted this way to the death, binding and putting both men and women into prison. As we're going through this, what I want to show you is that Paul was a Jew through and through. And growing up in this Jewish culture, and as we'll see, I want to lay out Paul's pedigree, if you will, that he was absolutely zealous for what he thought was the right thing. Turn over to Philippians chapter 3. Look at verse 3 and 6. We are the true circumcision who worship in the Spirit of God and glory in Christ Jesus and put no confidence in the flesh. Although I myself might have confidence even in the flesh, if anyone else has a mind to put confidence in the flesh, I far more. Circumcised the eighth day, all Jewish boys got circumcised, so he's following the law. Circumcised the eighth day of the nation of Israel, the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law of Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, blameless zeal. That word zeal means to heat up, to boil over with envy, with anger, with hatred. So would it be a fair assessment to say that Paul hated the Christians? Yeah, he did, with a great hatred. But again, he thought he was doing what was right according to the law. And in the first service, I forgot to do this, and my daughter reminded me of this, and she said, make sure you do it this service, Dad. So when she was little, her mom told me that when she got upset, she would stand, clench her fist, and go like this. So I think that that's kind of a picture of Paul and his anger towards the Jews with an intense hatred. Paul hated the Christians vehemently. Now, let's turn over to Acts 26. And we'll kind of mind this thought of Paul, who he was and what he was doing out just a little bit more. 26, verse 4. So then, all Jews, this is when Paul is standing before King Agrippa. The first time in 22, he's standing before the Jews in Jerusalem. So then, all Jews know my manner of life from my youth up. Even as a little boy, people knew of him, which from the beginning was spent among my own nation and at Jerusalem. Since they have known about me for a long time, if they are willing to testify that I lived as a Pharisee according to the strictest sect of our religion, the strictest sect, the Pharisees, separatist means to separate. They lived their lives according to the law. Drop down to verse 9. So then, I thought to myself that I had to do many things hostile to the name of Jesus of Nazareth. So because of how he was raised, because of what he was taught, because of the law, he thought that he had to be hostile to Christ. Again, doing what he thought was right according to his law, according to what he was instructed, and being zealous about it. but again, being zealously wrong. Going on in verse 10. And this is just what I did in Jerusalem. Not only did I lock up many of the saints in prisons, having received authority from the chief priests, but also when they were being led to death, I cast my vote. And as I punished them often in all the synagogues, I tried to force them to blaspheme. And being furiously enraged at them, I kept pursuing them even to foreign cities. So again, to say that Paul hated Christians was an understatement. Casting my vote to putting Christians to death. Stephen, ring a bell? Yeah. Yeah. Binding them and bringing them back to Jerusalem. But not only that, being fiercely enraged to the point of trying to cause them to blaspheme the name of Jesus Christ. So imagine this. On the road to Damascus to continue in this persecution of the church, he has an encounter with the head of the church. How do you think Paul felt when that moment happened? Knowing that the law exacts strict punishment if you break it, right? That was one of them aha moments, wouldn't you say? Yeah. Going on. Verse 12. While so engaged, as I was journeying to Damascus with the authority and the commission of the chief priests, at midday, O king, I saw on the way a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, shining all around me and those who were journeying with me. And when we had all fallen to the ground, I heard a voice saying to me in the Hebrew dialect, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? It's hard for you to kick against the goads. And I said, who are you, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom you're persecuting. He hears in a Hebrew dialect, in his native tongue. And then he says, who are you, Lord? I believe at that moment, Saul knew that it was the Lord Jesus Christ. Because he heard his native language, and he hears the voice, and then he says, who are you, Lord? And then notice what the Lord says. Why are you persecuting me? Wait a minute. No, I'm not persecuting you, Lord. I'm persecuting these Christians. You know what that speaks to? It talks about how close of an intimate relationship the Lord has with his church. And who is this church? Is it this building? No. Who's the church? We are. We are. Church, in the Greek, ekklesia. It means called out one. And so whatever happens to us, family, individually, collectively, it happens to the Lord. And I was talking to somebody a while back about this. I think they were going through something personal and how they were dealing with stuff. Multiply what you're dealing with, however heavy it is, in your own personal life, and multiply that by what? How many people in the world today? 6-7 billion people? And does not our Lord's heart bleed for all of us, even those that don't know him? Because the Bible says that he came to save what? Just Christians, right? No, he came to save who? Everyone. Even the Muslim in the Middle East that's extracting vengeance on his children. He says, you're persecuting me, Saul. It's hard to kick against the goads. What's a goad? Goad is a sharpened stick that farmers use to prod the ox forward. And many times the ox would kick back. And so you know what that's saying? That it's hard to kick against God's will, Saul. My will is to do something in your life. And know when the oxen kicks back, that's painful because it's kicking right back into a sharp point. So sometimes when we resist the will of God, it's painful. Anybody in here can say amen to that? Yeah, amen, it is. It's painful. God wants us to go a certain direction. He said, no, you're going in the wrong direction. And as he does, we're kicking back, and it becomes painful. Verse 16, but get up and stand on your feet, for this purpose I have appeared to you, to appoint you a minister and a witness, not only to the things which you have seen, but also to the things in which I will appear to you. So remember in the beginning I said, when we have a real encounter with the Lord, that there are certain truths that he reveals to us. This is the first one. Notice what it says in verse 16. Get up, stand on your feet, For this purpose, I have appeared to you. That word appeared means to show oneself. In other words, I revealed myself to you. Point number one, the only way that we have an encounter with Jesus of the third kind is when he graciously reveals himself to us. So we can't take credit for having this revelation of coming to Christ. The only way that we see God is through his gracious revelation of truth and who he is. Through his son. And we'll sing a song later on at the end, Kindness by Chris Tomlin. In the first stanza, the lyrics say, open up the skies of mercy. Mercy rained down on Paul that day on Damascus. Absolute mercy. Absolute mercy. Then it goes on in verse 16. To appoint you a witness, minister and a witness, not only to the things which you have seen, but also to the things in which I will appear to you. Point number two is that when he reveals himself to us, it's not to come in and kind of tidy up your life. You know, you got a marriage on the brink, and he wants to fix that. You got a job that you don't know what's going to go with it. Can you pray for my job? Yeah, pray for your job, and he wants to save your job. It says that Paul, I called you to appoint you a minister and a witness. Minister, that word means under roar. It means to serve with your hands. It means to be a servant. But it also says, I want you to be a witness. The Greek word that we get martyr from. And what's a martyr? Someone who dies for a cause. And so he said, Paul, I want you not only to serve, but Paul, you're going to die for me too. Now, all of us may not be called to die for the cause of Christ, but everybody in who is a Christian is called to die to self. Turn to Luke chapter 9. The Lord told Paul, you got to be willing to die for me. I submit a question to all of us today. Are we willing to die? Anyone who has a family, loved ones, wife, children, I'm sure men particularly would take a bullet for them to die physically. But you know what's more difficult? To die spiritually to self. Because the old man doesn't die hard. Amen? He's hard. Luke chapter 9, drop down to verse 23 and 24. And he being Jesus, was saying to them all, if anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake, he is the one who will save it. The cross, picture of the cross, represents a lot of things. It represents the love God has for us. Amen? No greater love than a man has than this, that he would what? Lay down his life for his friend. God demonstrated his love, and while we were yet sinners, Christ what? He died for us. So the cross is an absolute picture of God's love for mankind, for you and for me. But you know what it actually represents? Particularly back in that culture, it represented death. That's what the cross was made for. A very heinous, very extremely excruciating, painful death. And what the Lord is telling anyone that if you want to follow him, if you want to be a disciple for the Lord Jesus Christ, you have to die. God's not going to come down and crucify you. Paul wrote in Galatians 2, I believe it's 20, I've been crucified. It's no longer I who live. I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I live now, I live by faith in him who gave his life a ransom for me. The Bible tells us to lay ourselves down, to kill or crucify the flesh. And so God's not going to make us do that. And all he's saying is you have to willingly give your will to me. That's not always easy. And the old man doesn't die instantaneously. It's a process. It's called sanctification. And as you allow the Lord, God, Holy Spirit, to continue to invade your life and take control of your life, and you find out that, man, I thought I gave that to God. No, you didn't. Okay, here it is, Lord. And as you continue walking with him, you go a little bit further down the road of sanctification, and you find out that you haven't given this. Sanctification is a process, and we're not finished product until we see him in glory. But that revelation that you have from God, not only does he want to save you, he's saying, give me all of you. Not part of you, all of you. Okay. Verse 17, rescuing you from the Jewish people and the Gentiles, to whom I am sending you to open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness to light and from the dominion of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and an inheritance among those who have been sanctified by faith in me. So, he reveals himself. He reveals himself to show the work, the calling, a calling that he's called upon us to do. And then in here, he's very specific many times about the work that he wants us to do. But the work is about him. It's not about me. He didn't call me so that I could stand before you guys and receive glory. Look at what it says in 17. Rescuing you from the Jewish people and from the Gentiles, to whom I'm sending you to open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness to light, from the dominion of Satan to God, so that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among those who have been sanctified in faith, by faith in who? In me. The work that he's called you to is to bring glory and honor to the Lord. It's to glorify the Lord Jesus. So are you doing that in your life? Is God the reason why you wake up in the morning? Is God the reason why you take breath? Is God the reason why you're alive? That's why he saved you. That's why he revealed himself to you, so that we could bring honor and glory to who? To the Lord Jesus Christ. 19. So, King Agrippa, I did not prove disobedient to the heavenly vision, but kept declaring both to those of Damascus first and also at Jerusalem and then throughout all the region of Judea and even to the Gentiles that they should repent and turn to God, performing deeds appropriate to repentance. He reveals himself to us. He's got a call for us, to call us to glorify him. And then after he reveals himself to us and shows us what he wants us to do, then he wants us to just go ahead and say, thanks, God, appreciate what you showed me. I'm on. I'm gone. Nope. He wants us to be what? Obedient. Look at what Paul says again in verse 19. So, King Agrippa, I did not prove disobedient to the heavenly vision, but kept declaring both to those of Damascus first and also at Jerusalem and then throughout all the region of Judea, even to the Gentiles. Paul saw the vision. Paul heard the calling. And Paul was obedient to obey what God had placed before him. So are you being obedient, family? You may not be called to be a pastor. May not be called to be an evangelist. May not be called to be somebody that stands before God's people. But everybody that's in the body of Christ is called to do something. We're not called to just be, you know, cheerleaders sitting on the sideline. This is a participatory sport, if you will, this thing called Christianity. This is not a spectator sport. He wants everybody to get involved. So roll your sleeves up. Let's get busy for the Lord's work. Amen. Everybody. And know this. Thank you, Lord. This just came to me. That when you're serving the Lord, when you're serving the King, when you're serving the Master, there's no greater thing that you could be doing on this earth. I don't care how much money you make, and I don't care if you got the sweetest, bestest job in your life. There's nothing greater than serving the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Because there's reward in that. Because I'm doing something that's going to have an impact, an effect that's going to be lasting. Serving the Lord. Let's be about being obedient to what God has called us to. Now, turning back to Acts 9. I want to finish up in verse 9, even though we read it. And he was 3 days without sight and neither ate nor drank. So Paul has this encounter. 3 days not eating, not drinking. We'll see later on. Paul was praying, but he was also fasting. So I would say that was a pretty radical encounter that Paul had with the Lord. Caused him to take a pause and consider, right? Praying and fasting. That kind of encounter with Jesus will make you do that. It'll stop you in your tracks, and it'll have you consider. And I'm going to keep hammering this point, because I've met a lot of Christians since I've been serving the Lord through the ministry of U-Turn for Christ, many men who come through U-Turn for Christ who have claimed to have had a relationship with the Lord before. I'm not here to judge, but I dare say most people don't have this kind of encounter and live their lives out this way. But Paul's not anything unique, family. Paul's no different than you and I. Paul's a man. The Lord wants to use our lives to impact this world in a radical way. And I'm laying the gauntlet down. Would you take it up? Would you allow the Lord to use your life in that way? Whether it's in your family's life, whether it's in your life at the work site, wherever. We're living in the last times. These are the last days. You know, we got a country right now that's teetering on the point of craziness. But the Church of Jesus Christ needs to stand for what is right and what we believe in, family. To be a light that's in a dark place right now. Will you allow him to use your life in that way? Going on in verse 10. Now there was a disciple at Damascus named Ananias, and the Lord said to him in a vision, Ananias. And he said, Here I am, Lord. And the Lord said to him, Get up and go to the street called Straight and inquire at the house of Judas for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he is praying. And he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias come in and lay his hands on him so that he might regain his sight. But Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much harm he did to your saints in Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all who call on your name. So the Lord goes to this disciple named Ananias, and he wants to send Ananias to go to Saul to lay hands on him and to speak to him. And Ananias is like, nobody, I'm not going there. Don't you know who this guy is and what he's done? Absolutely not. But he's obedient. Verse 15, but the Lord said to him, Go, for he is a chosen instrument of mine to bear my name before the Gentiles and the kings and the sons of Israel. So here's another point. Look at verse 15. Go, for he is what? A chosen instrument. When God reveals himself to me, I'm chosen by God. Christ picked. And I thought about that as I was doing this study. A young man from the streets of South Central Los Angeles, didn't grow up in a Christian family, had a mom, a grandma, and a grandfather, didn't know my dad. And God used that life that I was definitely living about the things of this world. And fast forward that to now, that I might bring honor and glory to his name. Chosen. Christ picked. But it also says chosen what? Chosen what, family? Instrument. An instrument can't produce music by itself, right? It needs what? It needs a musician. It needs someone to hold it. And you know what that's saying? That if God wants to use me to bring sweet music to his ears, I got to let him play me. I got to let him use me. I'm that chosen instrument that God wants to play for his kingdom, for his glory, for his will. Are you going to allow him to do that? Are you going to be that stubborn instrument that says, don't touch me. I'm not going there. You can't make me. Chosen by God, Christ picked as a chosen instrument to bring honor and glory to him. Are you going to allow him to use your life in that way? Saul did. To bear my name before Gentiles, again in verse 15, kings and sons. And many times the calling of God is very specific. And then in verse 16 he says, I will show him how much he must suffer for my name's sake. Another point. Through the revelation of who Jesus Christ is in my life, he also shows me that there will be suffering. Maybe not to the point of death like Saul ultimately did. Saul was martyred. But there is suffering. Suffering for the cause of Christ. Go to 2 Timothy chapter 3. In verse 16, he says, I will show him how much he must suffer. Suffering is not an option for a Christian. And again, we may not lay down our life for the cause of Christ, but he says, Paul, you're going to have to do this. He says, I'm going to show you. And we'll see later exactly what Paul suffered from. But in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 10, it says, Now you follow my teaching, conduct, purpose, faith, patience, love, perseverance. persecutions and sufferings such as happened to me at Antioch, at Iconium, and Lystra. What persecutions I endured, and out of them all the Lord rescued me. Verse 12, indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus, maybe sometime you might get a little flat. Is that what it says? What does it say? What does it say, family? Will. Suffering for Christ is not an option. Suffering for Christ is not an option. Paul, I'm going to show you what you have to suffer from, what you will be suffering with. The sufferings of Paul. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. We just want to see a little bit of the suffering that Saul endured. 2 Corinthians 11, dropping down to verse 22, it says, are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they descendants of Abraham? So am I. Are they servants of Christ? I speak as if insane. I more so. In far more labors, here we go, in far more imprisonments, beaten times without number, often in the danger of death. 5 times 24 I received from the Jews 39 lashes. 3 times I was beaten with rod. Once I was stoned. 3 times I was shipwrecked. A night and a day I have spent in the deep. I have been on frequent journeys and dangers from rivers, dangers from robbers, dangers from my countrymen, dangers from the Gentile, dangers from the city. I'm sorry, dangers in the city, dangers in the wilderness, dangers on the sea, dangers among false brethren. I have been in labor and hardship, through many sleepless nights, in hunger and thirst, often without food, in cold and exposure. And apart from these external things, he says, there is the daily pressure of me on me of concern for all the churches. So not only did he go through these physical things, he had a huge burden for the body of Christ. Now, question. Remember, he says, I must show them things that he must suffer, right? Beforehand. Before he started doing his work, if God showed you this, would you say, okay, God, I'm ready. Where do I sign up? Let's go. Now, if I was honest with myself, are you kidding me? Absolutely not. So imagine the kind of impact, again, that the Lord had when he revealed himself to Saul. Even so much so that he was willing in the face of what the Lord showed him. Man, you're going to suffer all of these things. And then ultimately, remember, he gave his life. He was martyred, right? And Saul said, man, where do I sign up? Let's get busy. So why aren't we doing that? Why aren't we doing that? Why isn't the Church of Christ doing that? Because it's not going to get easier. As times move on, more and more Christians are going to be more and more marginalized here in America. And our rights are being snatched from us. Now, I'm not saying, you know, pick up a plaque and stand on the, what's the word I'm looking for? When people are standing and walking. I just had protest. Man, see your moment. Thank you, Lord. And you know, walk a protest line or anything like that. Although I'm not saying not to do that. When I was in California, went to the through the Ministry of U-Turn for Christ, one of the things that we did was picket abortion clinics. And I did that. And that's hard. But I'm not saying do that if God hasn't called you to that. But surely there's something that you in your own personal life could be doing for the cause of Christ. He showed Saul that. And Saul said, yet still, yeah, sign me up, Lord. I'm ready to go. 17, going back to Acts 9. So Ananias departed and entered the house, and after laying his hands on him, said, Brother Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road by which you were coming, has sent me so that you may regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. And immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales. And he regained his sight and got up and was baptized, and he took food and was strengthened. Now, for several days, he was with the disciples who were at Damascus, and immediately he began to proclaim Jesus in the synagogue, saying, He is the Son of God. And all those hearing him continued to be, underline that word, amazed, and were saying, Is this not he who in Jerusalem destroyed those who called on this name? and who had come here for the purpose of bringing them bound before the priest. Paul's on the road, traveling. He meets Jesus, and here's another truth as God reveals himself to us. Notice again what it says in verse 21. All those hearing him continue to be what? Amazed. Wait a minute. Wait, well, hold up. That's Saul? No, that's not Saul. See, Saul came here on a mission, right? What was the mission? To bind and bring those of the way back to Jerusalem. What is he doing in here talking about Jesus Christ? What happened? Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. You see, when I have this encounter, when Christ intersects my life, I become a new creation. I'm no longer the person that I used to be. 2 Corinthians 5, 17. Therefore, if anyone's in Christ, he's what? A new creation. Old things have passed. What happened? Behold, all things have become what? New. So if you've had this encounter, O man of God, or woman of God, are you a new creation? Are you new? So I want to share a couple of stories with you. The first one, a young man who's in the ministry of U-Turn for Christ. I meet with the leadership of U-Turn once a week. We met this past Friday. We're talking some things, and he just wanted to share a praise report with us. He said he talked to one of his brothers, and his brother shared with him this particular situation. I thought it was very apropos for this morning, that another brother of his came to the brother that he was speaking with and said, "Hey, man, where's Sam at? How's he doing? Is he still at that place?" Yeah, he's still there. Well, what's he doing? He's not doing nothing. He's still there. No, what's he doing? He's not doing nothing? He's not doing nothing? He asked him three times. He says, no, he's not doing nothing. Because Sam's no longer the individual he used to be. Amen? He's a new creation in Christ. And when I heard that, you'd have thought I just heard somebody won Powerball and just had $500 million given to him. I felt like a proud papa. That's how I feel about the men of U-Turn, because they're my sons in the faith. He's no longer the same. And God gives me the privilege of seeing the sanctifying work of the Holy Spirit in the lives of men. And that's a privilege. But then, and I'll share this with you, this is a personal story. You guys, some of you guys met my older brother who came here a couple of weeks ago, and we spent time with him. And I got a phone call from him a couple of days ago. And the conversation went something like this. "Hey, how you doing?" "I'm good." "Well, I just called to hear your voice. I love you. Bye." And that was it. Now, for some of you guys, you'd be like, okay, what's the big deal with that? Well, you got to understand, for 20-something years, I didn't hear my brother's voice. That's real. For 20-something years, I didn't hear my brother say, "I love you." For a long time, I didn't have a relationship with my brother. Now, for him to want to call and just hear my voice, that's God, because I'm not the same, and he knows it, and my youngest brother knows it. I'm here to submit to everybody in here. Men of U-Turn, you guys need to hear this. God didn't come into your life to give you a job, to give you your family back. He came into your life to change it radically, so that like Saul, when they see you, people are amazed. Amen? Amazed. I don't know about you. I don't know what kind of God you're serving. That's the God who I serve. He's in the business of doing amazing things. He's in the business of doing miracles. He's in the business of not withholding any good thing from you, the Word of God said, because he wants to show you off as his trophy. God does amazing things. And that revelation that God allows us to see reveals that truth about who he is. He's an amazing God. 22. But Saul kept increasing in strength and confounding the Jews to live in Damascus by proving that this Jesus is the Christ. I'm sorry, one last thing. Go to Acts chapter 13. I almost forgot this. 13:9. You see, when Saul had this encounter with the Lord, and I don't know if you guys have picked up on it, I've been saying Saul. I haven't been calling him Paul, at least I haven't been trying to. I've been calling him Saul for a reason. Because all of these things that we're talking about that he did before he met Christ, right? But after he met Christ, notice what it says in Acts 13:10. It says, but Saul, who was also known as who? Paul. See, his encounter was such of a magnitude that his name was changed. His name was changed. He's no longer Saul. And so I kept saying Saul because that was before Christ. Now he's Paul. Have you changed to such a degree that the things that you used to do before Christ, you're no longer doing? Because again, remember, he was in the synagogues and he was amazing people and he was doing all these things for the glory of the Lord. You might not get a name changed, but has your life changed? God doesn't radically come in, again, just to make my life nice. He comes in to change it. Going on. Going back to Acts 9. In 23, when many days had elapsed, the Jews plotted together to do away with him, but their plot became known to Saul. They were also watching the gates day and night so that they might put him to death. But his disciples took him by night and led him down through an opening in the wall, lowering him in a large basket. When he came to Jerusalem, he was trying to associate with the disciples, but they were all afraid of him, not believing that he was a disciple. But Barnabas took hold of him and brought him to the apostles and described to them how he had seen the Lord on the road and that he had talked to him and how at Damascus he had spoken out boldly in the name of Jesus. And he was with them, moving about freely in Jerusalem, speaking out boldly in the name of the Lord. 29. And he was talking and arguing with the Hellenistic Jews, but they were attempting to put him to death. But when the brethren learned of it, they brought him down to Caesarea and sent him away to Tarsus. And in verse 31, so the church throughout all Judea and Galilee and Samaria enjoyed peace, being built up and going on in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit. It continued to increase. Two final points that I want to show. Paul was teaching and arguing the Christ. But notice what it says in 29. And he was talking and arguing with the Hellenistic Jews, but they were attempting to do what? Put him to death. So this revelation that the Lord gives to us only by his will, because he reveals himself to us, he wants to show us the work that he has for us. The work is not about him. About us. It's about him. And then we might meet opposition. Paul met opposition to the point where people wanted to kill him. Now, you may not be a martyr for Christ again, but the truth of Jesus Christ is not always met with a welcome, is it? Nobody want to hear about that stuff. You Jesus freak. You fanatic, single-minded. Why is your way the only way? So that you might face opposition. But Paul, in the face of death, was willing to do that for the cause of Christ. And then finally, in verse 31, notice what it says. So the church throughout all the Judea, Galilee, and Samaria enjoyed peace. I don't think it was a coincidence that the church was enjoying peace now that Saul had been converted to Paul. I don't think that was a coincidence. Because remember, in the beginning, we saw him traveling to Damascus, breathing threats and murder, right? So when the Lord saved Saul, there was peace in all of the church. That's twofold, though. When Christ saved me on my road to Damascus, I found a peace. Because the Word of God says that there is a peace of God, and there's a peace with God. So if you're found in Christ, if God has revealed himself to you, are you enjoying that peace? Or are you still terrorizing the church? Remember before he saw the Lord on Damascus, he was terrorizing the church, right? And now what's he doing? He's teaching Christ. He's edifying. He's building the church up. So I challenge you, those of you who are Christians in this house today, are you terrorizing the church? Are you bringing peace to the church? Is your life being terrorized by the enemy? Are you finding peace in your own life? Because he's the Prince of Peace. If you've seen Jesus Christ, encounter of the third kind, face to face, I've seen Jesus, then I believe those truths that Paul experienced in his life are for us too. Amen? Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you that you're a God that only by your will you allow for us to see the splendor and the glory and the majesty and the power of who you are. And for that, we just want to say thank you, Lord. The great and mighty King of Kings and Lord of Lords reached down from heaven, opened up the skies of mercy and rained down. And I know that that's what Paul experienced, Lord. And I pray that that's the experience for each and every one of us this morning that's here gathered. Father, if there's anyone here that doesn't know you, Lord God, I pray that they would use this time. Your word that is spoken very clearly of what a radical change you desire to do in the lives of those who give way after they've encountered you. And so if you don't know him, open up your heart. Allow for mercy and grace to be poured in. You're such a gracious and loving and kind God. And then, Lord, as your revelation shows us that you've called us to do a work, Father, help us to be obedient to that. Help us to be willing to even lay it all down for the cause of Christ, that you might be honored in our lives, Lord God, for the sake and the cause of Christ. And Lord, if there's any opposition, help us not to be afraid of it, Lord. If there's any suffering, God, strengthen us. And give us the strength, Lord, not in our power, but in your might. And then, Father, may we enjoy peace. No matter what's going on the outside, no matter the turbulence, no matter the difficulty, no matter the storms that we're in, may we find the peace of Christ that surpasses all understanding in you. And may you receive the praise, the honor, and the glory. In Jesus' name.